بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على من كان نبيا وآدم بن الماء والطين وعلى الملائكة والروح الأمين وعلى آل بيته محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أصحابه الطاهرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Today, inshallah, we'll start the topic of Dajjal. This is a pretty significant topic for many reasons, and a very important topic for many reasons. The first reason I think it's very important is because when we talk about Dajjal, we obviously talk about his fitnah, and what his fitnah is largely related to Tawheed versus Shirk. So when we talk about Dajjal, we're talking about Tawheed versus Shirk. And Tawheed is unanimously agreed to be the most important topic in our deen, of course. So that's one of the reasons this topic is so crucial to talk about, that we get a chance to talk more about Tawheed. Another reason is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there is no fitna between Adam alayhi salam and the Day of Judgment that is more severe than that of Dajjal. So it is the single biggest test sent by Allah onto this planet, onto humanity. So if we can prepare for it as much as we can, and if we can stay one step ahead of Dajjal if he comes in our lifetime, and if we can have more knowledge on this topic and, you know, cling to the rope of Allah even more based on these talks and based on whatever we know about Dajjal, then inshallah we'll be better prepared to, with the permission of Allah, if he does come during our time, to be, you know, to repel his fitnah. And we should never hope that Dajjal comes within our lifetime, because some people like think, I don't know, it's cool or something, or it'll be interesting, or I want to show off my iman, watch when he comes, you know, he won't affect me. But my dear brothers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like I said that it is the most severe fitnah. So let us not assume such high hopes for ourselves. Let us not lean on our laurels. And we do not wish for, not just Dajjal, but any type of test to come upon us. We don't wish for that. But if it were to happen, we should have at least some preparation. A third reason why this topic is pretty important is because Dajjal, one of the signs that Dajjal will come is, and he himself has his own signs. He is one of the major signs of the Day of Judgment, but he himself has his own signs. When is he about to come? When is he about to emerge? One of the signs of his emergence, as the Prophet ﷺ taught us, is that the discussion of Dajjal will sort of disappear, fade away from the members. Khatibs will stop talking about Dajjal. So as long as we talk about Dajjal during our Jumu'ah, then maybe perhaps his time is not that close. You know. So this topic, we're going to start it today, but obviously it's going to take a lot more than 1 week to talk about it. Next week, Shaykh Ayyub, inshallah, will be back. Therefore, we actually have only today to talk about it, and so for that reason, I'm not going to go in a logical order. The logical order would be to talk about who is Dajjal, what does Al-Masih al-Dajjal even mean? That's just his title, obviously, it's not his name. So what does he look like? What are his characteristics? Where is he going to come from? What's he going to do? What are his fitan? How do we protect ourselves against that? This is sort of the logical order. We talk about his donkey. Everybody loves to hear about Dajjal's donkey. If you never heard about the description of Dajjal's donkey, it's a little bit surprising to most people when they hear it for the first time. So anyways, that would be the logical order. But my dear brothers, we're going to, inshallah, because of the number of weeks that we have, is only 1 week and we can't cover it. What I'd like to do instead of that logical order is cover it in priority order. So the most important topic, we're going to talk about that today. And that important topic is the concept of his fitna and shirk versus tawheed. So we're going to talk about that, inshallah. In order to talk about the fitna of Dajjal and the concept of shirk and how he's going to bring shirk and how tawheed repels that and the importance of tawheed, I'd like to. We could do this through many stories, but the story that I'd like to discuss is that from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, basically towards the end of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in an incident called Dhatu Anwa. So let me set the stage for this incident and this story. The Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims in general, they went through many phases. When they were in Mecca, as we all know, of course, they were persecuted. You know, they had no leg to stand on, they had nothing, there were only a few of them. They were being persecuted and even killed and martyred. Then when they went to Medina after the Hijrah, it was a little bit better in the sense that there was not that level of persecution. The Muslims had somewhat of a haven in Medina. And in Medina, every household had a Muslim. There were more Muslims. It was a more of a community. And there wasn't that same type of difficulty that there was in Mecca. But, my dear brothers, the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims were still facing threats, of course, as we know, Badr, Uhud, Ahzab, all of this happened in Medina. So they were facing threats, they were facing death from outside, from not just the Quraysh, from all the tribes surrounding them. And, Islam people, especially the Quraysh, were trying to destroy the Muslims. And after Ahzab, or at Ahzab, more than just the Quraysh, everyone was trying to destroy the Muslims. So it was a little better in the sense that they had a community and a haven of sorts, but it was still not that great. The third stage was after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. The Treaty of Hudaybiyah was very significant because when you're the Quraysh, for example, and you create a treaty and you enact a treaty with people who you think are renegades, your act of creating a treaty with these people is the same as, and is tantamount to accepting them as a force. Now the Quraysh have accepted the Muslims as a force. They've accepted the Muslims as a political entity. Islam now has status. That's very significant. And Allah revealed the ayat, in fact, the whole surah, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. Many people assume that this refers to the conquest of Mecca. It does not. إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. The Fath Mubin here refers to the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, because this is when Islam became a political entity to be dealt with. And of course, very soon after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah was the conquest of Mecca. The Prophet ﷺ took an army, a huge army of the Muslims, and he walked down from Medina to Mecca. They traveled from Medina to Mecca, and without any bloodshed, the Muslims and Islam and Allah conquered Mecca, and therefore the entire Jaziratul Arab. You have to understand that conquering Mecca is like opponents of the US saying, we've sacked Washington. Like, it's the religious capital, it's the political capital, it's the economic capital, it's the main center of the Jaziratul Arab. When the Quraysh fall, all of the Arabs fall, all the tribes fall. Taking Mecca is taking the entire Jaziratul Arab. This is a huge event. This means that the entire Arabian Peninsula has been conquered, has become rid of shirk, is going to be rid of idolatry, and Islam is going to spread. Islam started out less than 20 years before this as, a bunch of people who were being persecuted and were dying. Now it is the main political group. It's the main political party of the Arabs. They've taken over. And the Prophet ﷺ, as he was going into Mecca and he was performing tawaf after the conquest, he was riding his steed, and as he passed by the idols near and around the Kaaba, he knocked them down one by one with his staff, and he said, جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلُ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. This was a huge symbol that Islam had taken over. And my dear brothers, not too much later, after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, Islam would spread, especially at the hands of Umar radiallahu an, to the entire known world, basically. And these Bedouins would come in front of the Roman emperors, and they would say, "We are here to take your land." And the Roman emperors would laugh, and they would actually give them gold coins and say, "You're like children. Be off with you. Go back to your home. We'll pretend like this never even happened. Just go back home." Because these were like puppies in front of dragons. But my dear brothers, what happened? The Muslims took the Roman Empire, they took the Sassanid Empire, and Islam spread, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, towards the entire known world. This was nothing short of a miracle. And as we all say, historians are still trying to understand how this happened. And still trying to understand how this Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, took Mecca and took the entire Jaziratul Arab. This was a miracle. My dear brothers, now that this stage has been set, the Prophet ﷺ, after the conquest, spent less than 3 weeks in Mecca. Less than 3 weeks, when the Muslims got word that a huge army of about 20,000 people was being congregated outside of Mecca by the people of Taif, the Bani Thaqif, the Thaqif. They wanted, they saw that Mecca was falling, they saw the opportunity that maybe we can take over. If we take the Muslims, then the entire Arab land, that's ours now. So, And they also understood that, you know, paganism is going to die, Islam is going to spread, we need to have one last ditch effort. So they formed an army of 20,000 people, approximately. And when the Muslims got word of this, the Prophet ﷺ marched with the army of the Muslims towards what would become the Battle of Hunayn. This is an important battle. It's one of only two battles in which Allah Azza wa Jal references by name in the Quran. By name. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ and وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنٍ إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ. Two battles Allah names, Allah talks about by name in the Quran. Hunayn is one of them. But on the way to Hunayn, my dear brothers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was taking his army, this is when the incident I want to talk about occurs. As you know, many of the elite Sahaba were among this, were in the army. You know, Abu Bakr was in the army, Umar, Uthman, Ali radiallahu anhum ajma'in. They were all the elite Sahaba, they were in the army. But also the new Muslims who had just converted at the conquest of Mecca, they were also in the army. These were people whose Islam was no more than 3 weeks old, probably 15 days. One Sahabi in particular, his Islam was only about maximum 3 weeks, probably about 1 week. He became Muslim maximum about a week ago. His name was Abu Waqid al-Laythi. And he said some words that I want to highlight today, and those are words of shirk actually. We do not blame the Sahabi, in fact we say radiallahu anhu, because he was new. He had the excuse of ignorance, but we want to take a lesson for ourselves. He may have the excuse of ignorance, but the rest of us probably don't, because most of us, we grew up in Islam. And if we claim ignorance after having grown up in Islam, then what kind of an excuse is this, my dear brothers? So we do not say anything about the Sahabi. You can perform an act, a person can perform an act of shirk, but there might be an excuse like ignorance. So we do not call him a mushrik, he's a Sahabi, and we say radiallahu anhu. The Muslims came across a tree. The name of this tree was Dhatu Anwat. The tree was named because it was so lush, so green, so amazing. It was really a sight to behold because it was in the desert and there was nothing else growing around it. But this one miraculous tree growing in the desert, so luscious, so lush, so green, it was amazing. And so the Quraysh, they turned it into an idol. You know, Jahiliyyah. So they turned this into an idol. And they would have an annual festival around this tree. And they would actually sacrifice in front of this tree and for this tree, sacrifice animals. And what they would also do is they had a superstitious belief that if they hung their swords on the branches of this tree, it would be good luck. Maybe, I don't know, maybe someone hung his sword on one of the branches of this tree and he found that the next battle he won it or something. And so this spread and it became a superstition that if you hang your sword on the branches of this tree, you will win battles and this would be a form of good luck. And so effectively this tree became an idol. Again, it's called Dhatu Anwat. Anwat means like hanging, right? So you can call it the hanging tree. When the Muslims came across this, some of the Muslims, like I said, Abu Waqid, he said to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, ij'al lana dhati anwatin kama kana lahum dhatu anwat. May Allah save us. He said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, make for us a dhatu anwat, just like they have a dhatu anwat. He knew that this is Islam, this is new, we can't keep our old traditions, but maybe this new religion will offer me something else in lieu of the Dhatu Anwat. Maybe there's something equivalent in this new religion. My dear brothers, the Prophet ﷺ said that, Subhanallah, by Allah you have asked me exactly as the people, the Bani Israel, asked Musa ﷺ when they said, Ij'al lana ilahan kama lahum aliha. My dear brothers, let's understand this. Musa alayhi salam and the Bani Israel, Musa alayhi salam showed Allah showed through Musa alayhi salam so many miracles to the Bani Israel. The Tishri ayat ila Fir'aun, the Jarad, the Qummal, the Dafa'ir, the Dam, you know, the frogs and the lice and the locusts and the blood. And not to mention the staff of Musa alayhi salam, which turned from a staff into a snake and the snake back into a staff, and the yadul bayda of Musa alayhi salam, when he put it in his jayb and he took it back, it became brilliant, shining. And Musa alayhi salam was black, by the way, he's a black man. So his hand becoming white was like so white was a miracle. So my dear brothers, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam was highlighting that Musa alayhi salam, Allah showed through Musa alayhi salam so many miracles to the Bani Israel. Not only that, but he saved them after generations of slavery to Fir'aun. He saved them from by the will of Allah, from Fir'aun, and they finally made it out of Egypt. And then they saw perhaps what is the greatest visual miracle of all time, the oft-quoted miracle. He hit his staff against the Red Sea, and by the permission of Allah, it split into 12 ways, and each tribe knew which way to go, and each of the 12 tribes of Bani Israel made their way across the Red Sea, and the water on the sides of these paths were like mountains stopped by an invisible barrier. And when they made it to the other side and the army of Fir'aun came into the Red Sea, they saw the water drown the people of Fir'aun, and they saw with their own eyes the miracles of Allah Azza wa Jal. Subhanallah. And yet almost relatively immediately after this event, the very next event that happened in the story of Bani Israel, they came across a people, they saw them worshipping calves and gods, and they said to Musa, Ya Musa, ij'al lana ilahan kama lahum aliha. Subhanallah. O Musa, make for us a god just like they have a god. Here is Allah showing them miracles and signs, miracle after miracle after miracle, and they have the audacity to say, make for us a god just like they have a god. Allahu Akbar. Similarly, my dear brothers, we said that the conquest of Mecca by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was nothing short of a miracle. Nothing short of a miracle. Yet here we have some of the brand new Muslims saying, effectively, make for us a god, just like they have a god. My dear brothers, the point is that nowadays, we say, some of us say, different parts of the ummah say that in one breath, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. And in the very next breath, some people utter words of shirk, right after saying La ilaha illallah. Even if we are, you know, some people may be able to plead ignorance. Some people may be able to plead other things. And we do not have the authority to pass judgment on anybody. We cannot say someone is a mushrik or a kafir or something like this. If they claim Islam, then there's nothing that we can say. But definitely there are some acts that are acts of shirk. And there are some people, and may Allah save us, that say La ilaha illallah in one breath, and in the same breath or the next breath, they utter words of shirk. My dear brothers, nowadays we have incidents where people... different communities probably have their own sort of idols, but in the Desi community, you know, there's these things like taweez. You've heard of this, right? There's this like you get from a scholar or a peer or somebody, you get these taweez, and apparently they're supposed to help you, they're supposed to protect you. I think I told you the story once where I was watching a religious show, and I won't tell you which one. But on that show, there was supposedly this quote-unquote mufti who was giving away or selling this amulet, you know, this pendant, and it had the name, supposedly, of the Ashab al-Kahf. And he said, he was claiming that this will protect you. Not only is it not the name of Allah or an ayat from the Quran, this supposedly Allah says that nobody even knows how many of the Ashab al-Kahf there were. Allah says himself, nobody knows, only Allah knows how many of the people of the Kahf there were. And here you have supposedly a scholar who is saying that not only does he know the names, he knows how many, not only does he know how many there were, he knows the names, and if you wear it, this will protect you. This, I say this categorically and unapologetically, acts like this are acts of shirk. I cannot pass a judgment on a person, but I definitely have the Quran and the Hadith to go by to say that these are nothing short of acts of shirk, and I say that categorically and unapologetically, my dear brothers. Nowadays, we have our own dhatu anwat. We have our own things that we think can harm us and benefit us. My dear brothers, we need to remember that Allah is an-nafi' and Allah is al-dar. An-nafi' means the one who brings benefit, and al-dar means the one who brings harm. These things are only in the hands of Allah and nothing else. Yes, we use the asbab. Yes, we take medication, for example, the oft-quoted example. Of course we do that because this is darul asbab. This is an order of Allah Azza wa Jal. But the inherent ability to harm and the inherent ability to benefit is not within that medicine. It is from the order, from the kun of Allah Azza wa Jal. Nothing has the capable of harming or benefiting. We all say, fire cannot burn, knives cannot cut, nothing can happen except with the permission of Allah. If Allah wants, He will remove the permission from the fire to burn, and He will remove the permission from the knife to cut. And we see both of these examples in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. When Ibrahim alayhi salam was being thrown into the fire, he said, Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakil. Allah is sufficient for me. I don't need anything else. We are not anbiya. We need to use asbab, of course. We need to eat, we need to sleep, we need to get married and have children, we need to go to work, we need to make money. But my dear brothers, we need to realize that none of this has inherent inherently the ability to harm or benefit. Rather, Ibrahim alayhi salam understood that that harm and that benefit is in the kun of Allah, and he said, "Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakeel," and he was the first person to utter that phrase. And to this day, we use that phrase, "Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakeel." And so, when they threw him into the fire, which was still burning the birds, by the way, the fire was so hot that when a bird flew overhead, it would roast and fall into the fire. Ibrahim alayhi salam went into the fire, and Allah uttered the words of kun, and he said, "Kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim." Ibrahim alayhi salam said, "That was the best time I ever spent in my life anywhere." And the example of the knife, my dear brothers, of course, with Ismail alayhi salam. Here is the father pulling the knife across the neck of his son. He's sharpened the knife beforehand, and here is Allah azza wa jal issuing the amr kun, and his son Ismail is replaced by a ram from Jannah. My dear brothers, Allah Azza wa Jal shows us this in the story of the staff of Musa alayhi salam. When Allah Azza wa Jal asked Musa alayhi salam, "Wama tilka biyaminika ya Musa?" What is that in your right hand, O Musa? Musa alayhi salam said, "Hiya asaya," it's my staff. But then he voluntarily, enumerated the benefits of the staff. He said, "Atawakka'u alayha wa ahushu biha ala ghanami wa liya fiha ma'aribu ukhra." Musa alayhi salam voluntarily gave benefits of the staff. Then Allah said, "Throw it, alqiha." So he threw it, and فَإِذَا هِيَ حَيَّةٌ تَسْعَى. It became a ferocious snake, a slithering snake, huge python. And Allah then said, "Take it by the face and pick it up," and it was returned to Siratah al-Ula, its original form. It became a staff again. Allah is showing, my dear brothers, Musa alayhi salam, and us by extension, that something that we think benefits us, like Musa alayhi salam says, "The staff benefits me," Allah azza wa jal can utter two letters, kun, and it becomes a snake, something that harms us. And he can take something that harms us and turn it back into something that benefits us. There is no inherent ability in that staff or in anything to harm or benefit, or in that snake to harm or benefit. Rather, it is all in the order of Allah. And this, if we realize this, then we do not need anything, my dear brother. We do not need these crazy, ridiculous ta'weez, and we do not... But these are acts of complete shirk, and I say that again unapologetically. These are acts of shirk. And we do not have to follow a peer or, some... whatever you call them. We do not have to follow people who claim that they will bring us closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal is the connection of our two hands away, that's it. He is the connection of our face to the ground away, that's it. We do not need anyone between us and Allah Azza wa Jal. My dear brothers, what was shirk at the time of the Quraysh? We know that the Quraysh were on shirk. This is proven in the Quran time and time again. They were on shirk. What was the nature of their shirk? They believed in Allah. Of course they believed in Allah. In fact, Allah Azza wa Jal himself says that if you ask them who created the heavens and the earth and you and everything, who brings down the rain, سَيَقُولُونَ Allah. They will say it is Allah. But they had these idols. What was the point of these idols? They will bring us closer to Allah. We agree that this is shirk, and in the Quran this is called shirk. But what is it? What was the nature of their shirk? It was not that we are worshipping these because we think Lat created us, or Uzza created us, or Manat created us. No, they thought that these will bring us closer to Allah. So whether it's Lat or Uzza, or whether it's, what's his name nowadays? The people follow him, they're like, he will bring us closer to the Prophet ﷺ, who will bring us closer to Allah. Abdul Qadir Jilani. If these people will sort of get us closer to Allah. Wallahi, Allah is only this distance away from us. If we connect our hands, that's it. We are connected, we have a direct connection to Allah Azza wa Jal. Salat is our connection to Allah Azza wa Jal. That's why it's called Salat. Salat means connection. That's exactly what it is. So my dear brothers, let us remember this carefully, that anything that we think can harm and benefit, realize that that is only a sabab. It is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal to harm and benefit. And this is the fitna of Dajjal. That he will make us think that harm and benefit are only in his hands. My dear brothers, another extremely important point in the last few minutes is that not only should we realize that harm and benefit are only in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal, but we should do this even if everyone else is against us. And even if everyone else is on shirk. Of course, the Muslims, when the Muslims were new, there were very few of them. And the Ashab al-Kahf are a prime example of this. They were young men, teens and preteens. They were such young men. And they had no one else with them who was on Tawheed. Their parents weren't on Tawheed. Their family members weren't on Tawheed. Their other friends weren't on Tawheed. The religious norm was not on Tawheed. Everything around them was shirk. All they had was each other. These few people who sought refuge in the cave and at whose hands Allah Azza wa Jal performed a miracle by making them go to sleep for 300 years. Regardless of the fact that around them was nothing but shirk, they stuck to Tawheed. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he stuck to Tawheed, even though the only people who believed him and in his Tawheed was Sarah and Lut alayhi salam. These were the only people who believed in him, yet he stuck. And his father was not only an idol worshiper, he was an idol maker. We know this, right? His father was an idol maker. Yet these people, Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Ashab al-Kahf, they stuck to Tawheed no matter what problems were around them, no matter what shirk was around them. My dear brothers, when it comes to shirk and Tawheed, even if our life is threatened, even if our life is threatened, we stick to Tawheed. And this will be the fitna of Dajjal. He will have powers that will amaze us. He will have powers to rip off, give us death and bring us back to life. But my dear brothers, we have to understand that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who has the harm in his hands and who has the benefit in his hands. And even if everyone else is on shirk, we must stick to Tawheed. My dear brothers, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned that with Dajjal, there will be people who will know that he is a kafir. They will know that he is a fraud. Yet they will still be with him because they will be afraid of the harm that he will cause. They will be afraid of him. Therefore, they will stick to him for this reason. The Prophet ﷺ said that Allah's wrath will descend on these people. So may Allah save us from all the fitna in our lives. May Allah save us from the fitna of Dajjal, for it ever coming onto us. And if it does come at our time, you know the Prophet ﷺ said, we should be firm on our Tawheed. Be confident in your Tawheed. Be confident on your Islam. No matter what anybody else is doing, understand Allah is Nafir and Allah is Dar. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that when you see Dajjal, if you do, spit in his face. Wallahi, spit in his face. And have that confidence that I'm on haq and Allah is with me and Allah will protect me even if I die right now. That, you know what, that's even better. I'm going to a better place. May Allah give us tawfiq. May Allah keep us on tawheed. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum.